So one of the hottest topics right now is the topic of cryptocurrency online. And there are many of us here right now, including myself, who don't really understand too much about the topic. So I said, I went online, crowdsourced probably the two biggest experts when it comes to at least cryptocurrency here in the Philippines. So these two good-looking gentlemen over here are Ron Hose of coins.ph. Guys, thanks so much for joining me. And I've also got Miguel Cuneta of, we can read it over there, Satoshi Citadel Industries.
So digital currencies in general are basically assets that are backed on blockchain. So unlike traditional assets, it might be backed by either by a value store that's held at a bank or gold or by a government, right? So when the government is basically the one that guarantees the holder value, digital currencies are typically registered on blockchain in decentralized way, most of them in infinite supply. And so people can transact those assets directly from one person to another without having to go through an intermediary.
So it's decentralized, in other words, and it's through a blockchain. Now, stepping back, and I understand all these different things, and we'll try to go through them one by one. But the first thing we want to ask is, for example, for the regular persons out there, I understand physical money printed by the government, but it's difficult for me to understand online money. Who produces the online money? Because basically, physical money, we know that a sovereign government will produce money, but who is producing cryptocurrency?
The government said that let's stop using gold and let's just declare that the money has value. Mm-hmm. So, you know, it's actually money that is not backed by anything except the government, right? So when Bitcoin was introduced, it's more like a digital gold right now because, you know, it has all the properties of a good money, which is like scarcity and fungibility, and you know, you cannot counterfeit this. And then it evolved into kind of like, you know, what's happening now. People are using it kind of like a money, but not really. You know, it's like more than that.
I mean, the underlying answer is there is no underlying value to these assets. I think that's why you hear governments and central banks actually giving people notice and warning to understand that the value can go up. And
so it has sort of like the features of how we use fiat currency right now.
Yes. Exactly. Just imagine all the features of gold, but transportable over any communications medium.
So basically the value is by the people who use the cryptocurrency.
And that's what creates it. In the same way we value precious metals based on the market value, what the market decides on the value.
So it's not just sort of like adjusting your mindset to this entire thing.
It's funny to have this conversation because I'm sure, like, you know, 10 years from now, people are going to be watching this. And they're going to be thinking in their heads, or, you know, let's go 20 years forward. They're going to be thinking in their head, why do people think that there is value in a rock,
in a metal,
right?
Yeah. I always tell people that kids today, or little kids today, will when they become adults, will not understand a world without cryptocurrencies, without this kind of technology. So we never actually give investment advice. A lot of people look at cryptocurrencies and think, how am I going to invest in that? Like, how much money do I need to put in? It doesn't work like that. It's actually that this investment speculation part is just like another aspect of it, totally separate
from
the technology.
And so that's sort of like blinds us. Well, that's sort of what's the conversation that's going on online right now.
It's like a carrot in front of the, you know. It's what dangles in front of people to make.
And that's what everybody's going into cryptocurrency right now because they're seeing that big investment, large appreciation now.
Yeah, but then a lot of people stay because they start to understand the technology. They start to understand how disruptive it's going to be.
Can anybody create a cryptocurrency? Can anybody create a Bitcoin?
Yes. Not a Bitcoin.
Or at least a kind of Bitcoin.
It's open source.
So open source.
You can copy the code and change a little bit. Call it your own coin.
But then, how do you know, let's say, for example, for people who don't know, there's Bitcoin and there are other cryptocurrencies which are out there.
Yeah.
And anybody can put it up. So how do you know which ones you should choose when they're out there?
It's actually just purely a free market thing.
Okay.
Like, you know, you're free to decide. It's all voluntary. You know, it's like, not force you to use Bitcoin if you don't want to use it. Most people follow what others are using. There's like network effects. So that's why Bitcoin is so strong and dominant right now because it was the first one and it had...
So it's sort of like it's the first cryptocurrency, but there are other cryptocurrencies which followed in its wake.
Over 1,000 different cryptocurrencies in the world today.
And if we were a basic consumer, how do you know which cryptocurrency
you do your own research.
So that's where it comes in. That's the homework that you do over there.
No one's going to be able to like hold your hand through it. There are people like, I mean, we have our educational campaigns. We do talks like this. We try to educate our customers and everyone we can about the technology and how to use it and how to use it safely.
If you're looking to invest into cryptocurrencies, that's a different matter. And on that, I would give a very simple advice, which is don't. It's high risk, it's volatile, unless you really know what you're doing. And if you know what you're really doing, you stand an equal chance of making money and losing all of your money.
The way to look at it really right now is that I'm influenced by what I see on Facebook feeds, and really a lot of people are saying, hey, I'm making this much in crypto. That's why people are thinking that it's a great investment. Yeah. But maybe the other way to look at it is like exactly how you said, is that, I'm not looking at the investment side of crypto, but more of what are the benefits to the consumer of crypto. And maybe you can better explain to us right now, basically, because that's what coins.ph does. What are the benefits, let's say, for the regular Pinoy consumer of a cryptocurrency?
But this is still nascent technology. Mm-hmm. But if you're selling, funds over a protocol like Ethereum or Ripple or some of the derivatives of Bitcoin now, the settlement time is very fast. The cost of settlement is relatively low. Like, you can settle a transaction usually under a dollar, which enables, things like, for example, moving funds cross-border, like remittances, at a much lower cost, especially if you have very good liquidity for these currencies in the markets. So that's kind of like the first application people have thought about, it's very simple, is remittances.
But so, for example, like for me, let's say, for example, I can pay, using Bitcoin, I can pay my cell phone bill. Using my Bitcoin, but for the app, I have to translate for that app. Do I have to translate the Bitcoin into Philippine currency from the?
With our app, and I think also Miguel, we abstract everything that's crypto away from consumers. So actually, our app crypto is a feature in our app.
Okay.
The rest of the app is a straight up financial piece.
Similar to an electronic wallet.
You can cash in, you can pay your bills, you can buy load, you can send money to your friends by putting in their Facebook ID or their phone number.
I see.
And if you want, you can use the app to pay to merchants who accept payments over blockchain, or to do remittances with partners and accept remittances over blockchain.
So what do you guys think is happening? Why? Because people are seeing that you can make so much, that's why people are just putting so much money into Bitcoin without really understanding what's going on in Bitcoin. Is that what's happening right now in terms of people seeing this is the true benefit? I can make X amount of money, so I'll just keep on pouring money into.
So, number one, we always tell people not to do this, over and over again. Even our family members, they're like, oh, your Bitcoins are so high. It's already $15,000. I remember you were telling me about this when it was $100, but that's not the point, right? That's not why we got into the space. It's actually because we wanted to kind of change things and disrupt things.
So in other words, I understand, I get a better appreciation of it right now, but also since it is decentralized, that means that there is no regulation online for cryptocurrency?
The technology itself, it's regulated by the protocols that run the Bitcoin software, for example. Mm-hmm. So there are rules that are set in kind of in stone that cannot be changed. And it's a self-regulating network, right? But like, for example, our companies are regulated by the BSP.
Okay.
We have a license to operate as a virtual currency exchange. So, at the point where cryptocurrencies start to touch Philippine pesos, then the regulators will come in. But in general, it is unregulated, the technology itself, but the ecosystem surrounding it is and will be regulated.
Yeah, I mean, I think, being decentralized and being regulated are not actually mutually exclusive, mm-hmm. because the regulation applies not to the blockchain, but it applies to how the blockchain is being used.
I see. I get understand now. Okay. So there are some countries, obviously, that where cryptocurrency is well accepted, and there are some countries which are neutral, and there are some countries which are supportive. There are some which are against cryptocurrencies in the first place. Having worked with the BSP, it appears to me that the Philippines is very accepting of the cryptocurrency and blockchain technology. Is my understanding correct, since you guys are actually in that space?
Yes, I would say so.
Yeah. I mean, I think there's actually very few countries that have, outright said no. most of these countries are probably...
You wouldn't want to go there in the first place, right?
But, you know, I think most, you know, most countries have just figured out ways to ensure that this fits within the regulatory model. So in the US, you have to be FinCEN registered, for example, in the UK and Europe, similar measures.
But now, maybe the easiest thing is, let's say for somebody who's here listening right now, they go, okay, I understand now. I'm a lot of the different assumptions I've had about it have been dispelled, or myths I know about Bitcoin have been dispelled. How do I actually buy into Bitcoin right now in the Philippines?
Please don't buy Bitcoin expecting you're going to make money back. You're going to earn a bit because you're as likely to lose as you are to gain.
We have actually several services that kind of mimic what Ron does. We have rebit.ph, which is facing outside the Philippines for people to remit money to the Philippines using Bitcoin or other cryptocurrencies. So we convert this to peso and deliver it to your recipient in the same way you would go to Western Union and like, you know, send money. We also have a platform where you can buy and sell Bitcoins, buybitcoin.ph. You know, if you want to try Bitcoin, you buy some a little bit, you know, and try to use it, buy something online, pay for something, donate some money to a charity. A lot of charities accept Bitcoin. You know, get a feel of what it's like to be your own bank.
And then speaking about the future, what do you see for Bitcoin here in the Philippines? How will it transform business life here in the Philippines?
One of the big trends we're seeing in the next like 2 to 3 years is cashless payments. Right? And, cashless payments are very, very susceptible to what's called network effects, meaning the kind of the rise of one player that has very big market power, whereas a lot of players can actually compete in the market.
So the really big picture here that Bitcoin cryptocurrency is really assisting in financial inclusion.
Yes.
And improving transactions in the country.
It's an open interoperable protocol for fund transfer, basically. If you know at the core of it.
And that's the way that we should look at it.
And
I guess
anyone can innovate. Anyone has an idea how to use this better can come in and disrupt and you know maybe take over our market share. And if they can do it, then they should. You know, I think should be encouraged.
Well, Ron, thanks so much. Miguel, thanks so much for clarifying many of these issues which we weren't so clear about before we started this interview, especially for me. Now, if you've got more questions about cryptocurrency, blockchain, Bitcoin, or other coins we've got online, please feel free to drop us a message over here at our YouTube channel. Again, guys, thanks so much. Thanks so much for enlightening us. Thanks, guys. Thanks so much. Thank you. Right now with Attorney Ryu, but we're not here for his legal expertise, but rather his feedback as a consumer of cryptocurrency and Bitcoin. And I understand you've been using Bitcoin for quite some time now.
Yes.
At least relatively quite some time now. Mm-hmm. What turned you on to Bitcoin in the first place?
I had a friend who wanted me to join this community wherein they have to use Bitcoin.
Mm-hmm.
And then at that time, I didn't. This was back in 2014.
Mm-hmm.
So I didn't know anything about Bitcoin. And then he said, use coins.ph. So I downloaded the app and then I explored and then I saw, you know, Bitcoin. Oh, this is Bitcoin, okay? And then now I use it to pay money to a friend or whoever has the coins.ph app, depending on who the recipient is. I use it to pay Meralco, PLDT, Globe, load my mobile. They even have tuition fee payments in there. They're in partners with some schools like Miriam.
Wow. And so the functionality, the utilitarian purpose that Ron talked about earlier on was really something that you were able to take advantage of when it comes to Bitcoin.
Exactly. And then there's another thing, because recently I just came across this thing called 10X. They provide a Bitcoin credit card.
Oh, they do, huh?
Yes.
Oh,
you will get a physical card. So you load your wallet there with Bitcoin in the app. And then if you have like 10,000 pesos there, you can use the card to pay for a Starbucks.
Now, you've been here since 2014, and there have been no rally yet in terms of at least the price of Bitcoin at that time.
Actually, there was.
There was a rally as well.
Because Bitcoin was invented in 2009.
Okay.
By a guy named Satoshi Nakamoto,
mm-hmm.
whose identity is unknown to everybody.
Mm-hmm.
And at that time, one Bitcoin was worth like 0.008 cents mm-hmm. in US cents. That was less than 1 peso. Now it's worth 750,000, but in 2014 it was 16,000 pesos. Most people don't realize is that they can buy Bitcoin even for as low as 30 pesos.
Okay, but not the full Bitcoin. You're buying a partial Bitcoin, it's gonna be a fraction,
like 0.000.
Okay, so you can actually break up the purchase of the Bitcoin. You don't have to buy a full Bitcoin.
Yes.
I see. And then, why is it recently that, I mean, you've been there from when it wasn't seen as a quote-unquote investment vehicle or something you invest money in,
yes,
into something that's a big investment for people nowadays.
Mm-hmm.
So, how is it for you, being somebody who's been in the Bitcoin consumer for a relatively long time?
As long as it's still in our current stage, Bitcoin is not being used by, you know, 90% of the people in the world, unlike our Philippine peso. Bitcoin is very new to a lot of people, but if there comes a time that, you know, everybody is using Bitcoin, the value will be very high, but it's gonna be the one that's gonna be stable. So the way it works is Bitcoin's value keeps getting higher as more people use it, because it's the law of supply and demand. As more demand goes demand for Bitcoin increases, the price also increases.
So in other words, there might be some spikes or rallies, but eventually it'll stabilize to the point when it's going to be used by more and more people, and that will be the true value
of Bitcoin. Exactly.
But again, thanks so much for joining us, Tony Raya.
Thank you, man.
Thanks so much for enlightening all of us here who haven't gotten on the cryptocurrency bandwagon just yet.
Mm-hmm.
So right now, at least, it's easier for people to get a more, hopefully more informed decision before they enter Bitcoin.
Do you have a coins.ph account?
And that's what Ron told me to get right after this interview was done.
But use my referral link. You know why? Because you're going to get the free 50 pesos and me too. So that's like a marketing thing of coins.ph.
Okay.
It's like Uber before, you know, you get a free 200 pesos when you refer somebody.
Okay, great. Well, thanks, Ron. Thanks for that. Thanks so much, guys.
Hi, I'm Bianca Cruz, Senior Community Manager of this beautiful space. Here at Accelerate, we connect entrepreneurs, freelancers, and small businesses with each other through our space and our events. Accelerate offers a co-working space, private offices, meeting rooms, virtual offices, and event spaces. Work with us! You can learn more about Accelerate through our website, accelerate.ph.